to the afternoon session. We will have one lecture about linear response, and then we move to the computational room.
Yeah, exactly. So.
Okay.
Okay.
Davide, the stage is yours.
So maybe just an info before. So we are going to do the tutorials, and the idea is to use the virtual machine. I don't know if everyone has already set up the virtual machine. So you have to generate the SSH key, upload it on the website. So if you didn't, please do it now because it may take a bit of time to get.
I asked for help and I'm waiting for a reply.
Okay.
Because the procedure is that you produce this key, you upload, then you get instructions how to log in the virtual machine.
And I mean, you can produce the key now if you're going to use your laptop.
No, because the problem is that to use your computers, you need to pre-install Django, download the tutorials, it takes time. If you did it before, that's fine, otherwise, it's too late.
No, but I guess if the question is, can I use the virtual machine through my computer? Yeah, but.
He's asking if you need
but do you want to install Django?
I was asking, can we use your computer?
Our computers.
No,
but there will be some desktop there. I think they can use them.
Yes, you can connect with the desktop, but you are always to connect to the virtual machine.
Yeah.
So now the computing resources or CDP will be through this virtual machine. That is very much better than before because this virtual machine is a uniform environment. You got ACPUs each, but you need to activate the procedure yourself. Even on the computer, you need to log in with the username and password and then follow the instructions. You need a key to be uploaded. Yep. At least for today, it's not possible to run on your personal computer. Then for the next days, we can install it and do whatever we want. But
okay. I mean, yeah, then we will try. It's the first day. And
No. Okay. I mean, it's better than go big, try at least.
Okay. Okay, nice. Yeah, we were just discussing. Okay, I think we can start now. Okay, so. So now there will be a lecture about linear response before we move to the tutorials. And the idea is that I will introduce some of the concepts that we are going to use during the tutorials. So does it work? Now it's not working. I'll do it like that. Okay. So just I start a bit with the motivation. So the idea of using Django is that you start with a simulation. You do a DFT ground state simulation on some material, and you get the Knesham wave functions and the Knesham band structure. And then you want to use the Django code to compute some excited state properties. And in particular, in this lecture, I will focus on all the excited state properties that you can get with the linear response. And of course, what you compute is the microscopic linear response because you do a microscopic simulation. And then you want to connect with what is measured macroscopically. So I will discuss about this micro-macro connection. And you're going to use that to get some specific experiment. This is, for example, a plot of the absorption spectrum in bulk silicon. So the kind of experiments you have already seen them mentioned at least are absorption experiments where there is the light going through the sample and then the sample is absorbing some light. Or for example, the scattering of electrons through a material or a fixed ray where the electron is going in the material and then it's reflected back and detected. And so in all this kind of experiment, what happens is that you take some electrons, if you think about a semiconductor from the occupied state, from the valence band, and you excite it in the conduction band. But of course, the response function is not just these independent particle transitions, because when you excite the electron, then all the other electrons will react. And then in the absorption, you can see this fingerprint of all this interaction, all these many body effects as specific peaks that you cannot describe simply as a valence to conduction transitions. Okay, just I start with a cartoon just to motivate a bit why we want to start with the linear response. No? And the idea is that if you take a system, a material, or even a person in this case, and you you arrive there with a strong perturbation, a laser pulse, then it's very hard to describe, to foresee which will be the reaction. No? Depending on the person, the reaction can be very different. And this is true also for, in general, for a material. So if you arrive with a strong laser pulse, the reaction will depend on the material, but also on the perturbation. And instead, in the weak perturbation regime, the situation is much simpler. So if you perturb a person in general, you can predict much more easily which will be the reaction. And this mathematically is, let's say, the result is that the reaction depends only on the subject and not on the perturbation. So you can take it out, the dependence on the perturbation. And this is exactly, so this this function is exactly what we are going to compute, and it will depend on, as I said, your initial calculation, so the Knechtian wave function and the Knechtian energies. So let me reduce a bit this. So the kind of experiments we are going to consider, I will start with these, which are, I would say historically are the experiments which were described also when I was starting to study the linear response theory. Then if I have time, I will show also you something more advanced. And I will discuss in details all these microscopic theory that we are going to use. So how we can compute the neutral excitations of the system and compute the response the dielectric function via the response function and via this micro-macro connection. And in particular, how in the microscopic theory all the different levels of approximation enter, so from independent particle transition to the interaction describing plasmons, the role of what are called the local fields, the polarizing fields, and everything which is beyond that, which goes under the, let's say, umbrella of exchange and correlation effects. So first, the experiments again. So these three experiments, which you can see in the title, the first one is ILS, which stands for electron energy loss. And it's an experiment where there is an electron in, arrives to the sample, and then an electron out. And the detector is detecting the change in the energy and the momentum of the electron. And then you can plot the energy change and when as a function of, I mean, at which energy there is a maximum change in the intensity. And you can see, think as a first guess that the electron is exciting other electrons in the material from the valence to the conduction. But then, of course, you have many body effects. And for example, you can have also collective excitations. And then the other two experiments are very similar. This inelastic X-ray scattering spectroscopy is exactly the same, just you have an X-ray in and X-ray out, but then it's exactly all the rest is the same. And the last experiment is the absorption experiment where you have, let's say, a photon in and a photon out, or better, you have photon in and or less photon out because some of the photons are absorbed by the samples, again, by exciting valence to conduction transitions. So one difference is that for absorption, you just probe transition at transferred momentum zero, so the momentum of the valence and the momentum of the hole and the momentum of the electron in conduction must be the same. Instead, the other two experiments, you can also have a situation where you transfer momentum, so you start with a valence here, a hole here in the valence band, and then you excite electron at a different momentum. So what do they have in common? They have in common that experiments, you start from your DFT ground state and DFT total energy. The perturbation arrives and the system moves to an excited state with a different energy. And in general, you can excite, you can have excited state with the same number of particles as in the ground state, this big N, but you can also excite states which have one extra or one less electron. As long as you focus on this class of experiment and on the response function, you focus on these excited states. So we are focusing on the excited states which have the same number of electrons as the ground state. And as I said, this means that the electrons are just moving from the valence band to the conduction band and are not ejected. The energy range which you usually look into is the visible ultraviolet energy range, which is, let's say, the gap of most of the material, depending on whether they are semiconductor or insulators. And this class of experiment can be described by constructing what is the macroscopic dielectric function. The macroscopic dielectric function for absorption, the imaginary part, and the imaginary part of 1 over the microscopic dielectric function is what you needed for electron energy loss and inelastic X-ray scattering. So the question is, how do we compute this macroscopic dielectric function? Now, let's have a look to the field equations in a material. This is just classical physics. As you know, if you take an electric field, an external electric field, an external electric field is D, electric displacement, then the material will react with an induced polarization, and then you can sum the two to describe the total electric field. And in particular, the polarization and the total electric field are related by a function which depends itself on the electric field, but if you go to the weak perturbation regime, you can expand it linearly, and you have this alpha 1, which is the linear response of the system. And then if you take this alpha 1e and you plug it back, so p equal alpha 1e, you plug it back here, you have a relation between d and e, which is exactly the definition of the electric function. So the electric function is 1 minus 4 pi alpha, which is basically this relation between the linear response function and the dielectric function you are interested in. Now, the dielectric function is a tensor. It has different components. And depending on the momentum of the perturbation, so let's say that this is your electric field, it is a wave propagating along some direction, Q along Z, for example. And then you can split in longitudinal direction and in transverse direction. And so there will be a longitudinal component on the electric tensor, and there will be the transverse component and also the mixing components. In most of the materials, it is a very good approximation, if not exact approximation, to just consider the diagonal components, so just the longitudinal term and two transverse terms. So the transverse part is what you need to describe absorption. In particular, we said absorption, it's an experiment where you always probe zero transferred momentum, so you need the transverse tensor at zero momentum to describe absorption. So absorption captures transverse excitations. When instead the electron energy loss captures longitudinal perturbations. So if you want to describe electron energy loss at any momentum, you need the longitudinal dielectric function at any momentum. Now, the point is that at Q equals zero, these two quantities, so the longitudinal and the transverse response function, are identical, and so you can just care about the longitudinal one and, let's say, write your theory in such a way that you just need the longitudinal fields. And this is a great advantage because if I just need the longitudinal fields, this is the slide I had before. Now, the longitudinal fields can be expressed in terms just of a scalar potential, V. And then I can write everything in terms of scalar potential, and I can forget for a moment about the fields. Everything is scalar. And in particular, the scalar potential in classical electromagnetism is defined by the density. So I have a framework or a theory where the density is enough, and I can work within density functional theory, time-dependent density functional theory, for example. So in terms of the potential, again, there is a relation between the total and the external potential. It's the same one as before in between the fields. And in particular, the total is the external plus the induced. The induced depends on the induced density times the Coulomb potential. And then you can use this equation to write write the induced density in terms of a linear response function. And then you end up with a relation between the longitudinal dielectric function and this chi response function. So the difference with respect to before is that before we had a tensor, epsilon, and alpha was also a tensor. Here we have just the longitudinal component of epsilon and a scalar response function, which is the density-density response function. Okay, so If we do a simulation, let's say that we are able to compute our microscopic response function, then we need an averaging procedure to get the macroscopic response function. So in your simulation, Yambo is going to compute this, and then you need some averaging procedure. So you are going to get the microscopic dielectric screening, and then you need to take the average. So this is the meaning of these brackets. And now when you do the average, you can recognize that the wavelength of the external field in the energy range which we are looking at, it's much bigger than the unit cell of your material. So in the averaging procedure, you can take the external field and move it out of the average, because you're doing one average over the unit cell, and the field, you can consider it uniform in the unit cell. And so like that, you get that the average of the macroscopic dielectric function is nothing but the average of the inverse microscopic dielectric function. So let me stress that you have to do the average of the inverse. Yeah, this is what I was saying, you get the average. You have to do the average of the inverse, because if you write the relation like that instead, the total field will have the external field, which is still very slowly changing, plus the internal field. The internal field, instead, is the atomic field. It will change very quickly on the space scale of the unit cell, so you cannot take it out from the averaging procedure. So you cannot use this equation, because you cannot do this procedure for the dielectric function. So you have to stick on this one. Okay, so we have a procedure to do the average. We have to take the average of the inverse. Let's just focus now on the microscopic part. Now, the response function is the change of the density with respect to an external perturbation, and we need to figure out a way to compute it. So the easiest way is just to compute the independent particle response function, which is called chi naught. And this is well known in the literature. You have this, which is called the Fermi golden rule expression, where basically you have the poles of this object are the independent particle transition. So this delta epsilon means the energy of the conduction minus the energy of the valence, for example. So this is a very simple object to compute. It's just a post-processing of your ground state simulation. It's called independent particle approximation. But of course, it doesn't work very well in many cases, and then you need to go beyond that. So how do we go beyond that? And so for this lecture, I will use what is the framework of density functional theory, or better, time-dependent density functional theory. So the idea is that you have a system of interacting particle, you apply an external potential, and then the change of the density is very complex because of the interaction. So you map that into a system of non-interacting particle, and the price you have to pay is that now, when you apply an external potential, there will be a change also in the effective potentials, which is the mean field, which the particle feels. Now, the starting point of DFT is that your independent particle density describes exactly the interacting density to this effective potential. And then you can use that to derive an equation for the exact response function starting from the non-interacting one. So I try to do the derivation here. Okay, if you can follow, good. Otherwise, not a big deal. So this is the effective equation for this non-interacting particle, which they move in effective fields. So the effective field is my external field plus the classical field or Hartree field plus the exchange and correlation field. Now, when I do a variation of the external potential, so in real life, I have this equation, the total density of the interacting system will be chi, my linear response function, times the external field. In my non-interacting world, it's just the non-interacting response function times the change of this effective field, which is done by the change of all these components. Now, all these components, in particular the Hartree and the exchange correlation one, depend on the density. Since I'm in the linear regime, I linear expand these two terms. So there is a term proportional to linear in the density. And I call these two objects, these two functional derivatives, I give to them a name, which is the, let's say, the R3 term V and the FXC term. So let me. So you have the change of the R3 potential with respect to the density is this V. And then here I have the change of the density, and I use again the definition of linear response. The change of the density is chi, the change of the external potential. So this equation. Then I plug all this together, and then I end up with an equation which relates the total change in the density, sorry, the total response function to the independent particle response function. We can take away the external fields, and this is what is the, it's called the Dyson equation because it's a recursive equation. You start from the independent particle, and then you have terms where you can plug this back one time, and then again and again. And here you have the effects beyond the independent particle approximation. So now the idea is to have a look to this is some example and to see how they work. Okay, before doing that, let me mention that you are doing a simulation in periodic boundary conditions. So the Yambo code works on top of Quantum Espresso. So your response function, which depends on R and R prime, will be depends on a small r inside of the unit cell and the big R, which is the position of the unit cell. You can go in reciprocal space, so you do a Fourier transform, and then you end up with something which depends on G prime, and the momentum. And then the averaging procedure we were discussing before, so the average over the unit cell is just the G equal G prime component of this response function in reciprocal space. So you have this Dyson equation, we can have a look to it. So it has these two terms. So one term, this Coulomb interaction, is the functional derivative of the R3 potential. And it includes both the macroscopic and the microscopic classical induced field. And this FXC contains, let's say, the exchange correlation or the quantum induced field. And it is common to split this, the macroscopic, the classical term V into a macroscopic part, the classical macroscopic induced field, and the microscopic one. And okay, again, this one is this black box, let's say, which has all the quantum information. Okay, so let's have a look of how it works in practice. So what we can do is we take our full equation, as a first step, we remove everything and we just take the independent particle approximation and let's see how it performs. Let's say that I try to compute electron energy loss on bulk silicon. So I do this procedure with chi naught, and this is what I get. So is this good? And one way to check that is let's go to the next step. So this time we add the classical induced macroscopic field. We do the same procedure. And this is what we get. I think I'm missing This is what we get, and this is this black line. So the message here is, of course, the classical induced macroscopic field is super important. We cannot describe electron energy loss without, because we would be here. And indeed, with just this term, we have a very good description of electron energy loss experiment in bulk silicon. So this suggests that these two other terms are not very much important. So what if we move to absorption? So the blue line is by chance. I mean, there is a reason. If we try to compute absorptions, which is the imaginary part of 1 over epsilon to the minus 1 chi with this level of approximation, it comes back exactly to where it was the electron energy loss evaluated with chi naught. So you see, these and these, they are exactly the same. Now, let's say that this has a reason, and here as a start, we can use this as an information to get absorption in an alternative way. So instead of solving this full equation, we can solve an equation for a modified response function, which is called chi bar, which is a solution of the same Dyson equation without the macroscopically induced classical field. So if you use this chi bar, then you can directly get the dielectric function through this procedure. So in, you remove one piece and also you change your averacing procedure. So this is rather technical. You don't have to really understand that now, but the message is that when you will do calculation with Yambo, you will have some situation where we compute the full chi, some others where we compute chi bar, and this is the reason. So this again summarized here. So we have our full Dyson equation for chi, and we use it to compute electron energy loss, and this term is super important. For absorption, instead, we use a modified Dyson equation for chi bar. We don't have the microscopic induced term. And again, we can use absorption via an alternative averaging procedure. So this is the, let's say, correctly derived one. This is the alternative one. And the reason why we can do this change is somehow due to the fact that we can either define the response function to the external field, or we can also define the macroscopic response function, chi bar, as a function of the total field. So we can suppose that we know the total field and we just have to compute what remains. Okay, so we have discussed a lot the G equals zero term. What about the other two terms? So this other term is the microscopically classical induced field. And if you we do simulation in extended system, it does basically nothing. So this is in the inset. So the dashed line is without this term, the red dashed. The black is with this term included. And you see that in the beryllium solid, there are no changes. Instead, if you take an isolated atom, there is a big impact of this term. This is what is called in the literature, are called local fields effects. And they are important the more the system is not homogeneous inside the unit cell. So you do the simulation in a box. If the system is changing a lot inside the box, then this term is going to be important. In a solid, the density is more or less smooth inside the box, and so this term is not important. In an isolated system, the density, of course, changes a lot. It moves from zero to the maximum, and then this term is important. And if you move to some lower dimensional system, for example, 1D system, then you can already guess what happens. So if you look at the system along the direction of the material, then you see something which is more or less uniform, and this term is not going to be important. If you look at the material in the direction perpendicular, then the system is strongly non-uniform. And indeed, so this is the independent particle simulation. Now I switch on the field, and you see in the direction parallel, almost nothing changes. In the direction perpendicular, there is a strong shift of intensity at higher energy. And again, the same for, so these are nanowires, this is a nanotube, but the effect is the same. So this shift at higher energy due to the local fields is what is called the depolarizing effect. And I said that usually in extended systems is not important, but it is not always true. So this is the example of solid argon. You see the two lines are pretty different. And the reason is that some materials, despite they are bulk materials, they are pretty non-uniform in the unit cell. Okay, then the last term, this mysterious box, the exchange correlation kernel, which comes from the functional derivative of the exchange correlation potential, which is the functional derivative of the exchange correlation energy. So first of all, this term, we have no idea how to compute the exact one. We have to do approximations, and what we do usually, or at least the state of the art, or the first one is the local density approximation. So we pick up an expression of the total energy which depends on the local density, then we can do the functional derivative for the potential, which is a simple derivative, and then we can obtain the kernel, and then we have to extend that to the time-dependent domain. So we also do an adiabatic approximation, so here you see it depends locally on position and time, and then we can get the time-dependent potential, and from that the time-dependent kernel. Now, it's an approximation. I'm not going to discuss much this, but the main point is that due to this approximation, it's something which is local in time and also local in space. So it's a super local kernel. And well, in general, the effect of this thing, which is super local, are not so big. If you take an electron energy loss experiment like this one, so the RPA is the blue line, the black line is with on top the correction due to the FXC. It's not big, but it improves the agreement with the experimental data, which are the red dots. And this is the same for inelastic X-ray scattering, is more or less the same as electron energy loss. Instead, if you move to the case of absorption, this is absorption of bulk silicon, so the experiment are the red dot. The RPA is this green dashed line, and indeed, I mean, if you try this green dashed line, you would obtain that also without these two terms. You just add the local fields, nothing changes. You add this XC term, FXC term at the LDA level, and again, nothing changes. And you see we are a bit off. Instead of two peaks, we have this one peak and one shoulder. So here we are clearly missing something. And this is even more dramatic if I take solid argon, which is a wide gap insulator. So this is the adiabatic LDA solution, which is pretty similar to the RPA one. And this is the experiment. So here there is a clear peak, which is completely missed at this level of theory. Okay, and this is one thing we will discuss in the next days. So the reason of this failure is that we are missing the excitonic peak. Okay, I think I start to stop now if there are questions, and then depending on time, I have another presentation, or we can move directly. I don't know how we are doing. So let's see if first there are questions.
Response part is the core of everything. I mean, GW is a dielectric theory, then you understand why.
Yeah, so you have shown the last figure that, the imaginary part depends upon the interaction. I mean, like you have to take the excitonic effects here. Okay, so like, if your imaginary part is not so good, so how do you, when you do the Cramer-Kronig relation, you get the real part. So even your real part is not so very good. So, yeah. But like you assume that your real part is good and you do the calculations, right? So how justifiable is to use the dielectric tensor at an RPA level?
I'm not sure I got the question. I mean, of course, if my imaginary part of epsilon is not so good, also the real part will be not so good. I'm not sure what was the question.
So but we are using the one which is not good. I mean, like at RPA, we are not getting the good dielectric tensor.
Yeah.
But we are using the same things for every calculation. I mean, like you start with an RPA computing dielectric tensor at an RPA level, and then you feed these things to like a GW or anything.
Okay.
How do you justify the using?
Okay, I see. Yeah. Now I get it. So he's saying here for absorption, this thing is not a good description of the absorption. So we're saying it's not good. And why do we use it? Because in the next lectures, you will see we are going to use the RPA screening to build up the GW self energy, for example. But the point is that here we are looking at one thing, which is the absorption. And instead, when you look to the screening, what you are mostly interested in is that you have a good description of the plasmonic screening, which is somehow connected more to the electron energy loss. So, and I have shown you before, so here, that indeed, at the same level of approximation, the plasmonic peak is very well described. So. It's not good for absorption. It doesn't mean it's bad in general. It means it's bad in describing the absorption peaks and in particular the excitonic peaks. But In any case, it has a lot of good physics, and this is why we can use it as a starting point for GW and BSC. Yeah, maybe.
So there was a lady asking, wait, how do you do with the isolated systems? Is this applied only to periodic systems? How can we handle the isolated systems? Nadia Babaye.
Well, okay, in short, I mean, the code is designed for extended system. There is an implementation in GSpace which assumes, so we have a replica of the unit cell. But you can also do an isolated system. Simply you take your simulation box, you make it very big, and then you need enough vacuum around. And then there are also some other technical aspects. So you use, for example, a Coulomb cutoff for the interaction between the replica, and then you can also try to describe isolated systems.
Then El Achari Tariq asking, can we study disordered and the magnetic systems using YAML?
So I would say that in general the answer is yes, you can try, but it depends a lot on the system. Of course, these are ab initio simulations, so they are in general quite demanding. If you take a uniform material, you have a small unit cell. Then if you have to include disorder, you have indeed maybe a big unit cell with some defects. And then the computational requirements will increase quickly. Okay.
So usually you compute directly the longitudinal response, and this is like the standard procedure. So what can be like an hint that maybe you need to consider all the tensor?
I think in general it depends on the experiment. So there are experiments where they look at they also need the transverse elements. And then I would say that you can easily extend all the theory. The only drawback is that here we have everything which depends on the density. If you start to include transverse fields, then you need maybe a current density functional theory or polarization density functional theory. But this is not an issue at all if you do many body perturbation theory, because you have a theory which is a functional of the Green function, and it's enough to describe everything. I mean, I have a few extra slides on that, but I didn't have time to show.
Thank you.
There is, or maybe last, I don't know, but I think it's time to move.
My simple question, if you have a defect system, do we need another physics to explain what is happening in the vicinity of defect, or how do you?
So it means, do we need the?
Defects,
yeah. Yeah.
Yes. Do you need another physics to describe what is happening in the vicinity of defect, or how do you describe the system in this case?
So I would say one of the message, I mean, the final message of this lecture is that here we are capturing already a lot of physics, but we already miss something, which is we have to improve this LDA approximation for the response function. And this is true in an extended system, in a uniform system, and even more, I would say, in a system with defects. So. But again, it depends a lot on the experiment. So if you want to look at the absorption spectrum of a defect inside a bulk, yeah, most likely you have to go beyond this to use the Bethe-Salpeter equation that you will see. If you instead are interested in looking to the plasmon peak in a system with defect, I don't know, maybe you can try. I don't have any experience of plasmons in system with defects. But yeah.
I mean, the point is that the tool is completely agnostic with respect to the system. So if in unit cell, you can build up a unit cell with defects, disorder, or whatever you want. If you can handle it, you have a plane wave representation. Plane wave representation is pretty exact if you have a huge number of plane waves.
So you can project the density in a specific region. You can do whatever you want. It's not a big deal. So you need to distinguish the material complexity from the theory complexity. So material complexity is something that can be handled as soon as you have computational resources. No problem. I mean, YAMBA has been used, for example, to describe families of nanotubes with holes inside to describe amorphous material. I mean, this was done on Chinega, running on Chinega. Yeah, that's it. It's a unit cell. Then the question is whether you can apply the theory that Davide just mentioned with FXC to describe that specific material. But that's an issue of the theory, not of the unit cell of the material. You have to distinguish very sharply the two different problems.
So I guess we're going to move to the tutorials after this.
Yes, so now we will move there, and then we need to set up in order that we all run on the virtual machines. Okay, so move there.
A te non è arrivata, non è arrivata. Aspetta che...